We have two guests today too, so I just want to introduce them until now, but we have Father John and we have Father Joe Hart. They are kind of buddies, go way back. I guess they went to school together and they're still together. That's a miracle, you know, when two priests can get together. Father Joe Hart is instrumental for some of you who know the shrine. He is the man who began the shrine, cleaned the shrine, and built the shrine. So we thank Father Joe Hart for being, Monsignor Hart for being with us today. Father John was the one who kind of pushed it, you know? He was always there to make sure. He's like always saying, I do all the cooking and the washing up, and Father Hart does all the eating. That's how he puts it. But the scriptures tonight, the beginning of the gospel, Jesus is leaving his disciples. Can you imagine? He's leaving them. So there's apprehension, there's fear and anxiety in their hearts. And Jesus simply says, do not let your hearts be troubled. Have faith in me. Have faith in God. Beautiful words. And then you have Thomas come along and he says, but Lord, where are you going? He's still nervous. He doesn't know what's happening. He says, God, Jesus, where are you going? We want to go with you. And again, Jesus reminds us, have faith in me, have faith in God. Do not let your hearts be troubled. And of course, then you have Philip saying, but Lord, show me the Father so I can believe. Jesus again says, it's not about seeing, it's about believing. So the anxiety in their hearts are probably maybe like some of us. There are moments in our life where there's a lot of anxiety. And that first reading today from the Acts of the Apostles, there's even anxiety. Because the church is growing and the disciples can't take care of the people. So they need help. And they choose seven men to look after the needs of the people. Then we come to Peter. During these last few weeks, we've been reading the letters of Peter. Where somehow Peter, this very heart and soul of the disciple, who was nowhere near what he is today in the readings. The one who ran away. The one who denied that he knew Jesus. And today he tells us that you are living stones. He has experienced it in his own life. That his life has become something new. It has become something very powerful. And he's imploring the people to become living in your faith. You're not dead stones, you're living stones that God is going to build up, that Christ has come to empower you with his gifts. Then he says something very beautiful. You're a chosen race. You're a royal priesthood. You're a holy nation. You are a people set apart. For what? And then he tells the people, because God, Christ, has taken you out of darkness and brought you into his light. What is that light? What is it? It's simply, again, what Jesus said, do not let your hearts be troubled. Have faith in me. Where lives are full of anxiety. We ask ourselves, just like Thomas, where are we going? What's happening to me? I remember when I was growing up as a little boy, we had a pastor. And every time we asked him, you know, as kids in school, we always asked the pastor questions. And the question we were always asking him was, Father, where are you going? Even if he was crossing the street, even if we met him in the store, even if we met, no matter where we met, he always replied, I'm on my way to heaven. And that the real journey for each and every one of us. We are going to heaven. Don't be afraid. That's our wishes. That's really truly where our heart is. Pope Francis really reveals it in a very beautiful way to us. He constantly reminds us that the Word of God, the Scriptures, are joyful. And you know, he said, sadly in our world today, we fill our hearts with garbage. We fill our hearts with junk. And he says, we have to leave room for joy. We have to leave room for love. We have to leave room for mercy. And the only way we're going to receive that is from Christ. We have to let Christ into our hearts. Sometimes we build walls around us. Sometimes we close the door. But we must open the door of our hearts to let Christ in. Because he said, when you let Christ in, then you experience the joy, the love, the mercy, the healing of God. So do not be afraid. Have faith in God. Have faith in me. Tonight, you are asking for the gifts of the Holy Spirit. There are 10 simple instructions for the journey of life. And the first instruction I give you is simply this. Confirmandi, are you willing and ready to make God the center of your life?
Yes.
Wow. Father David, Father Richard, they're ready. So you want to have God the center of your life. How are you going to celebrate God? What kind of relationship are you going to have with God? Thomas kept saying, where are you going, Jesus? Philip said, prove it to me, show me. Are we going to trust in God, have faith in him? And the only way we're going to have a relationship with God is through prayer. Do we pray for one another? Parents, do you pray for your sons and daughters? Do you pray for your parents? So prayer is important to us. We can pray from our hearts. Speak to the Lord from our hearts. We can open the Scriptures. We can read the Word of God. We can sing the Psalms like we did tonight. And we can even be angry at God and still pray. Remember Job? Probably had his arms up in the air and saying, God, where are you? Why are you doing this to me? You have abandoned me. And he still had faith in God. So we must have a relationship through prayer. Then how do we celebrate God in our life? We celebrate through the invitation. Jesus Christ invites us to celebrate his life. He calls us into relationship. He calls us to remember him. One day out of the week, he asks us to come to celebrate in word and in Eucharist. You remember there a few weeks ago, we celebrated the road to Emmaus. The disciples are running away from Jerusalem because they heard Jesus has died. They heard he is resurrected, but they don't believe. And they're running away for their lives. And Jesus encounters them, but they don't recognize him. And they tell Jesus about all the happenings that are going on in Jerusalem. And Jesus starts explaining the Scriptures to them. And as he explains the Scriptures to them, what happens? Their hearts grow in anxiety. Their hearts grow with joy. And Jesus then says, I must leave you. And they say, don't leave us. Come and have a meal with us. Because the Scriptures brought so much joy into their hearts. And then Jesus went in and had a meal with them. And he took bread and broke it. And At that very moment, they recognize Jesus. When we come to church every Sunday, we're called to hear the Word of God. We are called to let our hearts be filled with joy, with the excitement of knowing Christ. And then we are called to this table. In a few minutes, we will take bread and wine. Use the words of Jesus. Say, take this, all of you, and eat of it. Take this, all of you, and drink of it. For this is my body. This is my blood. Do this in remembrance. That's the real celebration of Christ in our life. How do we live our lives as Christians? We pray, we celebrate, we imitate Christ. At the end of Matthew's Gospel, Jesus tells his disciples, go into the world, preach the gospel, live the gospel. Not just by word, but by example. He said, feed the hungry, clothe the naked, visit the sick, visit those in prison, and welcome the stranger. That's what it means to live your faith. That's what it means to know Christ. Parents, do you love your sons and daughters?
Yes.
Do you love your parents?
Yes.
You sure?
Yes.
Are you sure? Wow. That's a miracle. I used to be a principal, you know, in the parking lot on a Monday morning, the kids and students would come in and they'd say, oh, my mom, oh, my dad, they're such a pain. And of course, the parents would say to me, oh, they think we're a pain, but they're a bigger pain. No. We're called to love one another. What does that mean? It means that you love the other person, not yourself. The other person comes first. That's what it means to love. It is in giving that you receive. And that's such a powerful gift. God is a creator. You know, it's beautiful to go on the beach on a beautiful morning and see the sunrise, or to see the sunset, or to climb a mountain and look up at the sky, or to go out at night and see the beautiful moon. And we're intrigued, our hearts are beating with the joy of seeing how wonderfully God has made this world. Yet, the most important thing God has made is you and me. Each person is unique and special in the life, in the eyes of God. And yet in our world, sometimes we fail to recognize God's creation. We fail to recognize Him as the creator of all life. Because we feel we can decide when life begins or when life ends. Does that really truly reflect our belief and trust in God as a creator of all? Is it easy to speak the truth in our world today? No. And yet we are called to be prophetic. The world needs to hear the truth of the gospel. And yet we are afraid. We hear the words from Scripture. The prophets went out and spoke the truth. They were ostracized. They were ridiculed. Some of them even paid with their lives. But we need to speak the truth. We're asking for the gifts of the Holy Spirit, wisdom, knowledge, courage. We need to live our faith, imitate Christ, motivation. What motivates us in life? You know, some people are motivated by power. Some people are motivated by riches. Some people are motivated by pleasure. There are all sorts of different motivations. But what are we called to be motivated by as Christians, as followers of Christ? By love. By gratitude. By mercy. Unless these things are truly imprinted in our hearts, how can we live our lives? Purity of heart. You know, I said each person is wonderfully made here in the image and likeness of God. God has given you gifts that cannot be recreated.
You have the power to think. You have the power to feel. You have the gift of emotions. And the most powerful gift of all is the gift of your sexuality. And even that gift we destroy. Pornography destroys the person. It destroys the relationship. And I'm saying to you, are you willing and ready to let the gifts of the Holy Spirit purify your hearts so that you may live these gifts, share these gifts in a more real and fulfilling way? That's what Christ is calling us to more more real and fulfilling life. That's what Peter is saying in the reading today. God is calling us out of darkness into his wonderful light. That's what Peter experienced in his life. And that's what each and every one of us long for. To know God, to know Christ, because he is the way,